And welcome again to another lecture by DrX. Today we are going to talk about dynamics, and the topic is rotation about a fixed axis. This is the second lecture on the force and acceleration methods of the course of dynamics. Last week we talked about translation. You can search in this YouTube channel for the lecture about translation of rigid bodies. Today we are going to talk about rotation of rigid bodies about a fixed axis. And to start with it, let us continue with the presentation. Here we have a photo of our lab. This is a robot, and you can see that we have an axis passing through this circular shape. This is a fixed axis, and all the robot rotates as indicated by the pink arrow around this axis. Okay? So this is a fixed axis, and the arms of this robot, they rotate around this axis. So this is one fixed axis that is used for rotation around it. Okay, we have another axis as well in this robot, now indicated by this vertical pink line, and the motion is indicated by this arrow. Usually in robots, these kind of rotations are indicated as degrees of freedom. Okay, in our case, we are going to analyze structures on the plane. Remember that in this course we are talking about planar dynamics and what is happening to a 3D object when we are trying to solve the planar motion. Okay, this is a machine there, or a tool in the lab, and you can see this yellow axis, and we have these handles, and this is the axis of rotation of this lever or this handle of the machine that we have here in the lab. Some problems, as even if they are 3D in nature, as everything that we solve in engineering, can be analyzed as a planar structure. And like that, we can simplify a lot the equations of motion. Okay. Look at this bicycle wheel. This is located on this frame in the lab, and when it's like this, this is the center of rotation. When we have a three-dimensional object that is located on a plane, as in the case of this bicycle wheel, the axis of rotation is seen as a dot, as a point, because the axis is leaving the screen towards us and is perpendicular to the plane, as you can see, to the page or to the board, if you are solving problems on the board, okay? So, it's feasible or is valid to represent a 3D problem as 2D when we are solving the plane in this case, the plane of the photograph, and we have the wheel, and we are seeing as a ring, this wheel. But when we evaluate the properties of this rigid body, like the mass moment of inertia with respect to this axis, we will take into account that it's a 3D object, okay? What are the applications of this topic? Well, we have many applications. One of them is oil pumps. Okay, we have this mass here on this beam, and it's rotating about this pin here, located here. This is rotation about a fixed axis that is passing through this pin, and it's obvious that this mass is got a function there, and is providing a higher mass moment of inertia for this beam rotating about this, so that when this thing is working, it's difficult to stop it. You remember in our first lecture during this course that the mass moment of inertia is a property of a rigid body that tells us how difficult it is to change the rotational motion in that body, either if it is at rest, how difficult it is to start the motion, or if it is already rotating, how difficult it is going to be to stop it. Okay. And this property is taken into account when designing machinery like this one. You want the oil pump to continuously move. Obviously, that's why you need a huge moment of inertia with respect to an axis passing through here. Okay, this is what is indicated there on the text. You can read it, pause the video and read it if you want. Another application. In all mechanical labs, we have this kind of machine. It's an impact machine called the Sharpie machine. This is a pendulum here, a huge mass, and this thing moves, or when we start the test, this thing is located here in the vertical position, okay? And then you release it, and it's obvious that it's going to travel down with a huge angular velocity. And you place a specimen here, a sample of the material here, and it's hit by this, and it's got a point there, and you measure how much penetration you get on the sample, and like that you can tell how hard the material is. It's called a Sharpie machine. Your lecturers on materials can tell you more about this machine, but we have one here in the lab. I'm sorry I couldn't take the photo because it's quite well protected, because the machine has to be certified by a certain commission of labs, and I don't want to move it just and unbalance it, okay? But you get it. This machine is rotating about an axis that is located around here. That's why here you measure the angle from which you release it. I indicate this as a dot, but it's an axis leaving the page perpendicular to this center of this point towards you, okay? Now let's talk about equations already, and let us remember a little bit about our physics. When something is in angular motion or rotational motion, we get that Newton's second law can be expressed by these two drawings. Here we have the free body diagram, as you remember from translation, and this is the kinetic diagram. Now, when something is rotated about a fixed axis, in this case the axis is passing through O, and G is a different point, different position, we get a distance from the center of rotation to G indicated by RG. This is a distance. So the mass center will have two components of the acceleration: tangential acceleration and normal acceleration. In your courses of secondary school or high school, you were talking them about these accelerations, about them as centrifugal acceleration, centripetal acceleration. You know what I mean. Here in this course of dynamics, we call them tangential acceleration. You see that there is like 90 degrees here between the two accelerations, and they are multiplied by the mass. Like that, this product is already an inertial force, okay? This is a force due to the tangential acceleration. And this is also another force. And you know the directions of these accelerations are given by the rotational motion. If this is tangential, it's going to go like that if the angular acceleration is indicated by this arrow. And the normal acceleration is always going from the mass center to the center of rotation, and we call it AN. What are the values of these accelerations? Well, the tangential one is given by this alpha, that alpha is the angular acceleration times r, the distance from the center of rotation to the mass center. And then we have the normal acceleration indicated by omega squared, where omega is the angular velocity, okay? So if there's no angular velocity, there's no normal component of the acceleration, okay? Remember these scalar formulas because we will use them later in our equations of motion, okay? So this is the first equation you have to remember from now on. Equations of motion, okay? I tell you, this is Newton's second law. We are using a system x, y, we need to indicate our coordinate system and the positive directions. This is the rotational motion. Z is an axis leaving the page towards you. And this is using the right-hand rule. This is the positive direction of that rotational motion. Now we have forces, external forces acting on a body, a general body. We have couples or moments acting on it as well. Therefore, it's not going to be in equilibrium. It's going to be equal to the sum of inertial forces, in this case mass times tangential acceleration, and mass times normal acceleration indicated by these arrows. And also a new term that was not appearing when we had translation only is this. This is the inertial couple IG alpha, okay? So this is new compared to translation, okay? Sorry if I write this, okay? There you go. Now let's see what happens to these equations of motion in more detail in the next slide, okay? But before that, let us review the parallel axis theorem, okay? In the parallel axis theorem, we had this formula. We can't have the mass moment of inertia with respect to any other axis if we have the mass moment of inertia with respect to the mass center plus the mass times the distance square. Okay, this is the parallel axis theorem, and we can apply it here very nicely when we take the sum of moments with respect to a point O, that is the center of rotation, equals the Ig alpha, that is the inertial coupled, plus the moment that is producing this inertial force, mass times tangential acceleration times the distance. Okay, but if we substitute the value of tangential acceleration, you will remember that this time is something like this, alpha times r. So substituting this, we get a square of r, as here, times the mass, and alpha, we can take it out of the brackets. So this is our moment equation formula in an alternative way. Okay. Now, sometimes in your textbooks you will find normal tangential coordinate system. In that case, this is, in this direction is the normal direction, positive, and in this direction we get the tangential coordinate positive. Okay, like that, our components of the inertial forces are coinciding with the axis, as you can see here, and then they enter immediately here. Whereas in the previous slide, I'm going back one slide for you to see, or two slides, sorry. Here, what I'm telling you here is that you can see that if I'm taking x and y, this acceleration, the tangential times the mass, and this normal acceleration, we have to take their components with respect to x, if x is positive like that, and with respect to y, sorry, there will be a component of the tangential acceleration times the mass and a component of this force in x and another one in y to be included here, okay? Because these are normal and tangential accelerations that do not coincide with my axis. But there's no problem, because we can make them coincide, or we can use a normal tangential system as indicated here in this slide. Okay. Pay attention to this. In some problems it's even more appropriate to use the normal tangential, but you can always use the x and y. And either system you use, just keep in mind that you have to map these forces to the system, coordinate system you are using. Okay, because maybe for you it's more natural to do it on this free body diagram, but on this one you have to remember what is the coordinate system you are using. Okay, what is the procedure suggested for the analysis? First, establish an inertial coordinate system and specify the sign and direction of the components of the acceleration, as I just told you. Draw a free body diagram and a kinetic diagram, separate one. Show all the external forces and couples, and also the inertial ones on the right hand side in the kinetic diagram. As preliminaries, you have to compute the mass moment of inertias and other data you need. We call them that in Mexican Spanish, talacha. Okay, so do that. Write the equations of motion, and on purpose I included this number 4 in a bigger font, because we only have 3 equations. We cannot solve for more than 3 unknowns. So keep that in mind. If you need more equations, use kinematics to relate the unknowns with something that is already one of the 3 unknowns that can be solved by the equations of motion. Okay? You can pause this if you want to write down this procedure for analysis, but it's better we take a look at a problem, an example. Example number 1. We have this beam, it can be considered as a slender rod with these dimensions. Okay, as you can see, sorry, the G does not coincide with O. There's a distance between two of them. The mass of this thing is 15 kilograms. It is released from rest at this instant, and we are supposed to find the angular velocity, sorry, the angular acceleration at this instant, and the reactions at the pin O. Okay, the reactions of this support here. So obviously you know that there are going to be 2. One in Y and one in X. Okay. And also we want to know what is the angular acceleration alpha, okay, the three unknowns. As preliminaries, we can calculate the mass moment of inertia with respect to G as indicated here, but as we see, we have seen the moment equation, is sometimes it's better to find the mass moment of inertia with respect to O to use it directly in the equations of moments. And this is the parallel axis theorem. So this is preliminaries. You can pause the video to copy the problem before we proceed to the solution. Okay, here are the numbers. Substituting the mass and the length of this slender rod, we get this mass moment of inertia. Please check the operations because I haven't. Okay, so I just trust myself that I didn't make any mistakes in the calculations here. Okay, now it's starting from rest. That means that it didn't have any angular velocity, so indicated by omega. We know that the normal acceleration depends on the angular velocity. So if this is zero, all this goes to zero. Okay. This is our free body diagram. We have one reaction, another reaction, the weight, and that's it. Just by its weight, it's going to move. Then we have the kinetic diagram. We have this inertial couple here, Ig alpha, and we have the components of the normal acceleration and the tangential acceleration times the mass, both of them, to indicate inertial forces. This is not a diagram of accelerations. This is a diagram of inertial forces. That's why we have to include mass times the acceleration. Okay, and we know that if this thing is rotating like this, these are the directions of the tangential acceleration and the normal acceleration. Okay, now we are ready to write our equations of motions. Are you? You can pause the video anytime. I repeat, if you want to copy. And I remind you, these videos are better watched using high definition HD. Just go into the YouTube channels, you will see a little gear there on the window of the video, and you can choose at least 720p, that is normal high definition, but I think this video will be available in full HD. Okay, okay. Sum of forces in X equals what? Mass times acceleration normal, the normal acceleration. Okay, we have on this diagram only OX. But we know that the normal acceleration is zero because it started from rest and it didn't have any angular velocity. So therefore, our reaction in X is equal to zero. Okay. Now, sum of forces in the vertical, positive towards the upper part of the screen. Okay. Everything going up is positive. Equals what? This acceleration, but I don't have only this one. So here, instead of this, I'm going to substitute this by minus a t times the mass. Okay, this is this one. Okay, you see it's going down. That's why it's negative. Okay, pay very attention to this negative sign, because this convention here applies to both sides of the equation, to the left hand side of the equation coming from this and to the right hand side of the equation that comes from this diagram. Okay, substituting all the values, we get this equation. We have two unknowns here, alpha and the reaction, the vertical reaction. Still, we need another equation to solve these unknowns. Okay, so far so good, I hope so. Okay, as you can see, dynamics is pretty easy. You have to be just clear. You have seen my two videos so far that I draw the two diagrams. I just hate it when students come to ask in tutorials why they don't find the answers to the exercises or the examples of problems, and I don't see any of the two diagrams, or I only see arrows. You see, it's very important to include here the road, the support, all the surroundings. This is the free body diagram. And this is the kinetic diagram. We have to see the physics of it. This is what makes us an engineering major. Okay, we have to solve real problems. We are down to earth. We use the physics to solve engineering problems. Okay, let's go to the moment equation now. Now, it is useful to write it with respect to O, because we have two unknowns passing here, O, Y, and O, X. And what is doing moment positive in this sense? The weight times this distance. This is Rg. Okay, this value here, Rg, is coming from here, the distance from O to G. Okay, this is Rg. Okay, here equals what? Okay, we can take advantage of this Ig alpha plus. You see that this inertial force is got a distance to O, that is Rg. Okay, so force times the distance give us a moment, is here. Okay, but we have seen in previous slides that this is the parallel axis theorem, and immediately we can just substitute all this by IO that we calculated in the preliminaries. It was 1.35 alpha. And you can see we can immediately solve the here for alpha, and we get the value of alpha, the angular acceleration. We have these two equations. From this equation we solve alpha and we get this value. And we can find OY by substituting the value of alpha in this first equation. Okay? I'm just quickly going to check my operations here. I think I should be fine, but you never know, because I told you I didn't check before, and it's always useful to double check. Yes, it's fine. Okay? Any questions? Please comment here on the video, or if you are my student, ask me in class, or come to my office to ask for any questions you have about this problem. Or on Facebook, you can find me there as Miguel Rodriguez, also known as Dr. X. Okay. Okay. As you can see, very simple problem, what we just solved. Our first example of rotation about a fixed axis. Now, example two, an assembly of two bodies. We have here a sphere with a slender rod making up for a pendulum. This is a pendulum about this rotational point here. Okay, now this is rotating already with an angular velocity of 5 radians per second. Okay, it's indicated there, 5 radians per second. Okay, so immediately when you see an angular velocity, you should think of a normal acceleration. Why? Because you remember the formula for normal acceleration depends on the angular velocity. We have two options here before we proceed to the solution. We either consider this as a whole, one assembly of two bodies, and then we find the mass center and we proceed as indicated here, or we can consider both bodies separated, separately, but in the same equations of motion. What I mean by separated and separately, I mean we don't have to calculate the mass center and the mass moment of inertia at the mass center and then translate it to O. We can't just include them individually. This is the way I like it. Okay? Please don't think that this is wrong. I just find it more useful or easier for me to use this approach. I don't know. It depends on you. Okay? On this video, we will see this approach. So let's see what is our free body diagram and our kinetic diagram. Okay, free body diagrams, the weights of the two things, the rod and the sphere, the reactions, vertical reaction and the horizontal reaction. And I include these distances here. This one here is the Rg for the rod. Okay, and this distance here is the distance from the center of rotation to the mass center for the sphere. Okay, I call it SPH only, okay, not to write all. There are two different distances, so we have to consider that later on. Now, for each body, we will have inertial forces, mass times the normal acceleration for the sphere, and mass times tangential acceleration for the sphere. And also, we have the mass times normal acceleration for the rod and mass times tangential acceleration for the rod, as well as the inertial couples, Ig alpha for the road and Ig alpha for the sphere. Okay. Let's see now our equations of motion. You can pause the video to take a look at this free body diagram and the kinetic diagram. So do so if you need it. Okay. Now, as preliminaries, this is Talacha that you can solve before. Let's see what we know. We know that the mass of the sphere is 20 kilograms and the mass of the rod is 5 kilograms. We know that the radius of the sphere is 0.25 and the length of the rod is 1 meter. Okay? Keep all this in mind. These are given. This is data. Or data, as you may pronounce it. Now, from tables we have these formulas for the sphere, the mass moment of inertia with respect to the mass center. Please check my operations as usual. And I get these results. For the road, I get this as the mass center. Also check the operations, please. And then the distances, we just identify them in the previous slide. See previous slide for these distances. Those are the distances from the center of rotation to the mass center of each body. Then we have an angular velocity that is 5 radians per second. The formula says this angular velocity square times the RG give us the normal acceleration. So this is the value of the normal acceleration for the sphere, and this is the value of the normal acceleration for the road. Please check my operations again. Then we get this as tangential acceleration, but we don't know alpha. This is an unknown. So this is can be considered kinematics. Okay, this is an extra equation. Okay, we will substitute later on, and the same for the road. You can see RG is for each body a different one, 0.5 for the road and 1.5 for the sphere. Now the weight of the sphere is this, 20 kilograms times 9.81, that is the gravity in the international system, and the same for the road, 5 kilograms the mass, 9.81. The gravity gives us this as the weight for each body. Okay, so these are preliminary. I suggest that you always find all these preliminaries before getting into the equations of motion. Like that you can all have this in the same part of your solution, and you just go back to check what is the correct value when you substitute numerical values. Okay. Now, equations of motion. Let's start with the sum of forces in X. We have on the external forces only the reaction OX here, the only one from the free body diagram. But then we have two inertial forces, one for the sphere and one for the road. Okay. And this, we already know the values of those inertial forces. After substituting, we get what? Just we get this value for the reaction in X. So this is already one unknown less is solved. That's why I separated the equations of motion in boxes. Now, vertical forces. We have sum of forces in Y. And we have positive going up, but this and this one are going down. That's why they have negative signs. I indicate here negative because they go down. Okay, and we are considering positive going up. Now, on this diagram, we have the weights going down. That's why they are negative. And we have positive reaction. Okay, equals these two forces going down. That's why the negative sign again, I repeat. I substitute the weight of the road and the weight of the sphere. Maybe there's a small mistake here, I don't know. I think it should be 49.05. Sorry about that. And you can update here this value here. Okay. To let me see. Well, nevertheless, you can check. It's a very small typing mistake here. but this is the equation we have, two unknowns we don't know, and we have to use the moment equation. That's what we are going to do next. Now, moment equation, we can write it with respect to O. Okay, if we do that, these two weights times their respective distance will give us the moment, considering positive in this direction. Equals what? We have here for each body the IG alpha for the road plus the moment that this inertial force is producing with respect to O. Here we have 0.5. Okay, this force times the distance will give us the inertial moment due to this inertial force, mass times the tangential acceleration. And the same for the sphere. The sphere, I have here this IG alpha for the sphere plus the moment that is producing this inertial force, mass times tangential acceleration times the distance, and in this case is 1.5 for the sphere. Okay. After substituting the values and making all these operations indicated here, you can pause the video now if you want. You get this, and this is the value of alpha. Okay, so just taking into account the small correction you have to do to the equations of the vertical reaction of y, you substitute this, that's what I'm going to do next in the next slide, you can get the value for y. You remember there was a small change here, there must be a bit less than this, and the reaction should be something similar to this. Okay, check the operations, please. Now, this is the summary of the results. We have an assembly of two bodies, a sphere and a slender rod, and connected the two of them, it makes a rigid body, a pendulum, that is already rotating with its angular velocity. The question, the beginning of the problem, was the value of the reactions, the vertical one and the horizontal one, and what is the value of the angular acceleration. We just solve the problem and we get this. Just keep in mind that there might be a small variation here because of the decimal and the typing mistake on the previous slide, but nevertheless it should be something very close to this. OX is correct, and I think this is also correct. Okay, this should be something approximate. Okay, so you can see it was easy to solve this problem, taking the two bodies in a separate way. You can also find as an alternative solution the mass center and find there the sum of masses as one weight and so on, and the inertia moment with respect to this point, and translate it with the parallaxis theorem to O, and then solve the equation of motion. It will be a bit simpler, but you have to do a lot of preliminary work by finding the mass center and the mass moment of inertia at that mass center. Okay. You can pause the video now, or otherwise we'll see an alternative way. Or let's see what else what can we take from this video about rotation about a fixed axis, and what else can we say about this example. Okay, this is an alternative solution. We had this moment equation, but if we substitute the value of the tangential accelerations in each body, here at the rod and the sphere, we get this. And if we have to take alpha out of these brackets, I can put it out, I get this. And what is this? This is the mass moment of inertia with respect to O for the rod, and all this is the mass moment of inertia with respect to O for the sphere. Okay, please check my equations. I'm sure that I'm not pretty sure that they are all correct, because I just finished this presentation. It's just out of the oven, freshly baked for you. So if there's any mistake, please let me know, and I will include it in a comment or some appearing message there in the video. But look how better this equation of moment can look in the kinetic diagram if we take into account the parallaxis theorem, and we just write this from the very beginning. So in our preliminaries, we can just find the mass moment of inertia with respect to O directly, and we avoid all this, okay? And it will be exactly the same. Solving this will get us to this solution for alpha, okay? So there are two ways, many ways to arrive to Rome. as the saying goes, and I'm sure you can find alternative ways, but always keep in mind equations of motion are three for planar problems, and you have only the possibility of solving for three unknowns. Okay, you have to use kinematics, and that's what we use with tangential acceleration to substitute it in this moment equation here. But if we see this of the parallaxis theorem, this, I don't know, property or this thing we have just realized, we can just use it directly anytime we have a problem of rigid bodies rotating about a fixed axis, finding only the mass moment of inertia with respect to that axis, in our case O. And then we just include all the IO alphas for all the bodies as a sum. Don't get scared with this sign. This is indicates that we are going to include all the bodies indicated here by I, going from 1 to n, IO alpha, as we did just in the previous equation here. This is the road, this is the sphere, and we calculated the IO alpha for each. Alpha is the same for all the bodies because they are connected, they are moving together, rotating about a fixed axis. Okay, so basically this is it about a quick lecture about rotation about a fixed axis. I hope you enjoy it. This is DrX. As usual, you can use this for your own purposes of education. All the photos are mine, and I'm a professor of engineering mechanics and in Tecnológico de Monterrey in Puebla, in Mexico. And this is September 2015. Nice talking to you again. I hope you enjoyed the videos. If so, please leave a message for the feedback. I always like to improve my videos. And we have 161 people, I mean countries, from which people watch my videos. So let's see if we can increase that list. People as far away as Vietnam and Taiwan watch the channel from time to time. So everybody, welcome. I'm glad that you enjoy the videos and that you can take a bit out of them for your own learning. So again, nice talking to you. This is DrX from Mexico. Bye.